So the first part, pretty harsh. Why did your BIM fail? Why did it fail?
There's many reasons why they could fail. Maybe we just got off on the wrong foot. Starting gates weren't ready. There's a lot of things that can happen at the very beginning of a project, as you can see.
I think I've been on many BIM projects that have felt like exactly like this. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you have too, but it's a common feeling. You want to get started quickly, and there are so many challenges. Everyone has different capabilities, yep. And sometimes it just feels like this. Yeah. So why are some projects starting like this, and what are those failures like?
Yeah, well, sometimes we don't have the right team involved. Expectations aren't aligned, bad communication.
It can be really difficult to communicate.
Yeah, before or during the project. Deliveries, they're just not what we expected. There was no quality checks, deliverables. And then, you know, maybe we just didn't use it. You know,
Even if it was verified.
Yeah, the contractor, architect, owner, maybe they just for the wrong reasons or did the BIM for the wrong reasons and there was no use. So obviously there's a lot of wasted time in that.
So why is that so difficult? Why is it so tough to align expectations? Take a look. The one there was bad communication.
Right.
And we see this a lot. Here, a couple of examples of really poorly defined scope. The first one is a one-liner. I think a lot of people have seen this in contracts where the owner, somebody is requesting BIM and it's just, please can I have some BIM? And the statement of some kind of maybe an LOD. But the one that we see here, which defines milestones, and if you are using LOD numbers, a progression from one milestone to another that goes from 100 to 200 to 300, it just doesn't work like that on a project. And that's been something that we've been fighting for a long time. And it is a misconception that really does give bad communication about what the expectation is. And what's possible, what should be requested.
Mm-hmm.
So
then there's many variables that we need to consider.
It's
not just a number. Each number can mean so many things. So a lot of the standards out there are trying to define in one number the level of geometry, the information, and then also what elements to consider or to add to whatever the BIM use might be. But as you can see here in this chart, there's how much information are you going to add? How much scope? How much geometry information? And then you add up all the variables, but you're supposed to fit that into five categories or five numbers.
A scale.
At most. Yeah, a scale.
There are so many permutations. Yeah. Yeah, but like covering accuracy as well. Right. What's the measured accuracy? What's the represented accuracy?
Right.
What standards are you going to follow? What's the purpose? Why are you doing BIM in the first place?
Flexibility is what we've heard.
So if you did get all of that defined, what happens
just,
then?
Just go.
Yeah, ready,
we're
set,
ready.
Go.
Yeah.
Let's go. But unfortunately, without planning and without that sequence of events and without understanding of when the deliverables are going to occur, we have bottlenecks and we get a lot of deliverables that maybe we need to review all at the same time, lots of model deliveries.
Might end up falling flat on our face like those motorcycle guys.
We may well. And we get models, but if we have a poor QA process, this looks like a BIM.
It looks like a good model. It does.
But I can see some clashes there.
And you know, we might have had a good plan, but what about our QA process? You know, there's a lot of efficient processes out there that we can use, but what are, you know, if we don't have that aligned internally or the right tools to support that, you know, we could be wasting a lot of time going through element per element, making sure that they meet the initial requirements that we agreed on.
Absolutely. So
then we have to look at the team, right?
And there's two sides of this equation. Mm-hmm. It's not just the people creating models. It's also the people requesting models. Are we competent enough to request the deliverable? And are we actually competent enough to provide the deliverable? There's two parts to the equation. And competency is kind of an interesting one because BIM hasn't been around forever.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are new people learning BIM and they should be requesting, but it maybe is needing some support in the first few set of projects. So how much experience does somebody have? If you've got great attitude, great skills, you still need some experience and some knowledge over time. What are you really doing? What are your goals and how are you achieving that?
And you know, understanding where you fit inside of your company or where your company is a really good thing. It's not, you know, if you're still, you know, in the knowing part of I know BIM or I may know how to do BIM, you know, it's not a bad thing. It's just knowing that you might, knowing where you fit would help you maybe not overcommit to something that might put a lot of potential risk in a company. So
yep.
Just knowing exactly that competence of yourself or the company is a really good thing.
Yep. Don't overstretch, for sure. And then there's some great competency frameworks out there. There's some, so Bilal and the BIM framework has some great foundations to build from on your own. And then some of the examples that we've seen, which is a competency questionnaire that people send out. This is one example I love, where it asks for a company mission statement and whether that mission statement incorporates BIM and whether it incorporates Lean. Some of those principles incorporated into a company's mission statement can really understand, you can get an understanding of what that company is trying to achieve.